Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Raising an Entrepreneur, 10 Rules for Nurturing Risk Takers, Problem Solvers, and Changemakers, by Margot Machol Bisnow. Foreword by Elliot Bisnow and Austin Bisnow. Narrated by Allyson Ryan. Foreword. As teenagers, we must have given our parents fits. We wanted to take big risks for big dreams. We embraced being ourselves rather than conforming. One of us wanted to start a company, the other a band. We were the only people we knew committed to doing either. We wanted a life of adventure and a chance to do things that hadn't been done before. Our parents could easily have suffocated our aspirations. Instead, they believed in us. The only career rule in our family was to make sure we did what we loved, because that was going to make us the happiest and most successful in the long run. Our parents helped us figure out what we loved by exposing us to as much as they could. And because they believed in us, we weren't going to let them down. We're an extremely close family, so even when we moved away, Mom met our new friends, many of whom, like us, wanted to build things out of nothing. She started asking them how they came to be like that. To her amazement, and ours, they all said basically the same thing. My mom believed in me. Mom was really moved and wanted to shout this revelation to the world. So we told her she had to write a book. Then ensued a bunch of excuses. I don't know how, I'm too old to start a new career, yada yada. But we told her that with this much wisdom and passion, she would figure it out. We said, you're the one who told us to believe in ourselves. Now it's our turn to tell you. We believe in you and know you can create whatever it is you want if you want it enough. Being an entrepreneur and starting something from scratch is hard. Believing you'll succeed when the entire world tells you it's impossible is a challenge. It feels as if everyone thinks that your dream is a waste of time and that you shouldn't even try. The only answer is to believe in yourself. But before you believe in yourself, someone else has to believe in you. And that someone else often appears to be a mom. We are so proud of our mom for writing this book. And we're excited that she's sharing these incredible lessons with parents and kids around the world. Thank you, Mom. We love you. Elliot and Austin Bisnow. Introduction. It's the classic question every kid gets asked by almost every adult. What do you want to be when you grow up? These days, more young people than ever before answer with some version of, I want to be an entrepreneur. Entrepreneurs are not only the new doctors and lawyers. They are the new pro athletes and pop stars. Doing your own thing seems both possible and desirable. In survey after survey, those who have entered the workforce during both a deep recession and the golden age of the startup, and those coming behind them, say something like, I want to control my destiny. I want to design my own life. I want to make the world a better place. I want to do what I love. I want to have a startup. Many of today's bright kids look to the self-made self-starters who shatter the rules and come out on top. They want to be the kind of independent people who don't need to find jobs because they create their own. And this is their time. For parents, these ambitions can sound both compelling and unrealistic. Does I want to do what I love mean I'm going to start a niche design company with my friend, or I'm going to play video games for a living? Spoiler alert, it could mean both. Not everyone can be Mark Zuckerberg, we parents reason. Wouldn't it be better to choose a career with a safe, clear path? To earn a degree that will get you a job in an established company, or even at Facebook for that matter? It might be. Not everyone can tolerate, much less thrive on, the risks and uncertainties of an entrepreneurial life. But for some of our kids, it's the ideal path to success, fulfillment, growth, and joy in their lives. This is true whether they are destined to be the next Zuckerberg or to start a small local business, build a sustainable career in the performing arts, or found a nonprofit. All of these are entrepreneurial paths. You may not know if your child will be drawn to the entrepreneurial life, to the freedom and excitement of starting something all her own. Yet there's plenty you can know and do right now to help her develop her qualities and reach her potential. This book will help you get a picture of what your role in raising an entrepreneur might be. What matters? What doesn't? Though I am the mom of two happy and driven entrepreneurial sons, these are questions I never thought to ask. When our kids were young, my husband and I could not have foreseen the career paths they would follow. We had no clue. Looking back, I would have loved to have read real-life stories about how entrepreneurs had grown up. Not just Bill Gates and Steve Jobs, but people who would have been easier for us and our kids to identify with. People like the ones in this book. It would have given my husband and me an idea of what our boys might be working toward, a lifelong pursuit they find meaningful. Not knowing how this most important of all stories, our child's growing up, will turn out can be nerve-wracking for parents. It can fill us with some very understandable doubts and fears. The world is changing so much and so quickly. How can we make sure they're successful and ideally happy over the long run? The uncertainty and the high stakes can make us want to play it safe. What about money? When I talk to others about entrepreneurship, the dreaded M word often comes up. I found two common misconceptions about entrepreneurs and money. The first is the fear that if your children spend their life pursuing their passion, they won't make enough money to live. Parents who witness a child's total immersion in some favorite pursuit, making music, playing video games, taking things apart, building Lego sets, playing a sport, may feel it's their duty to set limits on the activity, for fear that if it takes too much of the child's time and attention, the child will neglect serious pursuits and be unable to make a living as an adult. Or parents may urge a college-age son or daughter to take certain types of courses, stay enrolled in college until graduation, and maybe study for an advanced degree, even though their reluctant collegian has zero interest in following that advice. I have nothing against academic and professional degrees. My husband and I both have graduate degrees, and it's worked for us. But a degree may represent an expensive waste of your child's time if it has no connection to his interests, and if his only reason for being in school is to get the piece of paper or make the contacts needed to land a high-paying job. And someone who loves something enough and works hard enough at it will find a way to turn it into a living, even without a degree in that field. More importantly, they'll be happier than if they were plugging away at something they don't enjoy. And I also believe that they will never be great at something if they don't work nonstop at it, and they will never work nonstop if they don't love it. Michael Mulligan, head of the Thatcher School in Ojai, California, cites research showing that many millennials are depressed because they've had to work so hard to succeed in areas of their parents' choosing. "We can do better," he writes. The truth is that we are all going to have to work hard to succeed in life. And if that is the case, let's at least try to work hard on things that matter and that we care about. A second misconception about money is that it's what drives entrepreneurs. I don't buy it. To the contrary, everyone I talk to insists they pour their passions into their business to make a better product or service, or to make a difference in the world. Even if you don't take their word for it, it's hard to imagine anyone sustaining the energy cheerfully to survive 18-hour days, nonstop funding worries, and the vagaries of the marketplace if their only motivation is a wildly speculative and, at best, long-delayed pot of gold. Duke Business School Dean Bill Boulding says, "Tomorrow's leaders should care about making the world a better place, not making money." He says what they are looking for are people who care about others, who see that the success of others is what makes them successful, and who have a sense of purpose and want to make a difference in the world. Cunningham, 2015. Spotting a future entrepreneur. As I researched, interviewed, and wrote this book, my idea of what an entrepreneur is evolved. For the purposes of this book, an entrepreneur is anyone who starts something, who comes up with an idea and makes it real, who translates a passion into a project. This means that entrepreneurs, in my view, are not just founders of for-profit businesses, but also people who start nonprofit organizations and profits for purpose that are changing lives. Entrepreneurs are actors who organize their own production crews. They're musicians who put together a band and find a manager and a music publisher and an agent. They're activists working to create a better world. How can you tell if your child has an entrepreneurial mindset? There's no sure giveaway, but there are some signs. Your son is a terrific student, but none of his classes excites him as much as something he does after school. Your daughter would rather tinker on her computer, or paint, or sing, or build Lego villages, or sell Girl Scout cookies than do anything else. Your child enjoys taking charge and loves organizing things or events or people. Your daughter is always questioning why things are done in a certain way, and she's always thinking of new ways to do them. Your son would rather spend 10 hours doing something he loves than 1 hour doing something he's not interested in. And even if he has trouble concentrating on his homework, when he's doing what he likes, he works with great focus and intensity. Your child loves selling things or starting little businesses. Your children are passionate about sports or other forms of competition. Even if you don't think you have a budding entrepreneur sitting at the breakfast table, you might be surprised. Most of the people profiled in this book weren't obvious future entrepreneurs. And that's another reason it's so important to keep the path open for your child. In most cases, you won't know which way they'll want to go until they're older. It can be hard not to try to direct your child's professional future, at least in general terms. Won't making sure he succeeds at what he attempts encourage him and build his self-esteem, leading to future success? Actually, the opposite may be more likely. Shouldn't she be pushed to excel in school? Not necessarily. So do you have any influence over what your son or daughter will become? Over the course of my interviews with over 60 thriving entrepreneurs and/or their moms, I found that the answer is a resounding yes. You do have that power, just maybe not in the ways you expect. The rule of all rules. Believe in your child. As I talked with entrepreneurs and their moms and thought about what they told me, I became aware of a single rule that holds together the 10 raising an entrepreneur rules I discovered. Every child is unique in some way, so help your child figure out their gift, and then nurture it and support it. That's the secret, and it sounds simple, but it can actually be very difficult to sustain over the course of many years and through many small but pivotal moments. It means believing in your children's strengths and letting them know you have confidence in their ability to succeed at what they love. I believe all parents want their children to grow up to be happy and successful. But many kids are unhappy because they aren't doing what they love. They may not even know yet what they love. There may not be any space and time to discover it. Instead, they're doing what their parents think will make them successful, and by extension, happy. So it's not just about loving your child and desiring their happiness. I believe most every parent does. It's not about wanting to help your child succeed. Again, I think parents do want that. It's about believing in your child's strength and letting him know you have confidence that he can succeed in doing what he loves. That's the baseline condition for raising an entrepreneurial child: unwavering belief in your child's abilities and a mindset of supporting her in developing them. Simple, but not always easy. Raising a child to be proud of his skills, to be confident, to be fearless, and to have a strong work ethic seems to me like a fine approach with any child. But I've become convinced it's essential to nurture these traits in a future entrepreneur. If they have these traits, your kids may not become entrepreneurs. But if they don't, they definitely won't. Successful entrepreneurs need a level of confidence, drive, resilience, and courage that's different from that needed to be successful in someone else's organization, whether that's a big corporation or a startup. In certain ways, the things you do to nurture the entrepreneurial mindset look similar to the things you do to support any child. But raising an entrepreneur can call for approaches and attitudes toward parenting that may be somewhat different from the ones you're used to. And that's where this book comes in. The Secret of All Secrets, Mom Power. In writing this book, I took the point of view of a mom, which is what I am, rather than the perspective a sociologist, an academic, a psychologist, or a family therapist might bring. I wanted to find and share the stories of dozens of families to discover and distill the parenting secrets that launched a group of creative, confident entrepreneurs on their paths. A young person today can make a career out of almost anything. The world has changed so much over the last 20 years that someone who wants to start an enterprise doesn't need an office, employees, a battery of attorneys and accountants, professional investment advice, or a bank of phones. Today, there are only three requirements for becoming an entrepreneur. 1, a great idea. 2, a heck of a lot of confidence. 3, the ability to work enthusiastically around the clock. Actually, make that 4 things. You probably also need a mom who provided the kind of support we'll explore in this book. This book will tell you how dozens of moms in dozens of different situations, whose kids' interests were all over the map, raised super successful sons and daughters, even if the road they were traveling didn't always look so promising. Now, don't get me wrong, dads are critically important. Many entrepreneurs credit their fathers, grandparents, step-parents, and others with having influenced their development. The rules I discovered apply to anyone nurturing a young entrepreneur-to-be. In my exploration of the subject, though, it's moms, rather than dads or others, who are identified as the secret ingredient in fostering their children's self-confidence and tolerance for risk, two important traits for an entrepreneur. So how did I zero in on the moms? It was an organic process, and it started before I had any idea that I might write a book on raising an entrepreneur. It started with my meeting scores of successful young entrepreneurs, mostly through my older son, Elliot, who founded the Summit Series, a conference for young leaders in a wide range of fields. When I met these remarkable young people, I usually asked them the same basic questions. How did you become the person you are? What made you so confident and so willing to put everything on the line? Who had the biggest impact on your life? They all told me a version of the same thing. I couldn't have done it without my mom. She believed in me. She supported my passion. She's the reason I turned out this way. That really struck me, and it moved me. I know that the moms of other teenagers and young adults, some of whom seem to be floundering, must love their kids as much as these entrepreneurs' moms love theirs. So I decided to interview the entrepreneurs' moms to try to learn what they had done right. I thought I might find something significant. I cast a wide net. I chose several dozen young men and women with a variety of interests and skills, creators and innovators from different ethnic and socioeconomic backgrounds, geographic settings, religious traditions, and family structures. It was as I interviewed mom after mom that I started to see more and more clearly that, while in some ways each person's upbringing had been different, in a handful of key areas they all had been raised the same. I was astonished to discover that all of these entrepreneurs' moms, without consciously realizing it, without knowing one another, and without having a common background, had followed most or all of the 10 rules you'll find in this book. Rules that emerged and became clear to me over the course of my interviews. I had to share what I was finding, and I decided to write this book. For the purposes of researching the book, I interviewed either the entrepreneur or his or her mom or both. Half the entrepreneurs profiled are men, half are women. They have vastly different interests and skills and come from different backgrounds. Some grew up well off, some struggled financially. Some came from big families, some from small families, some from blended families. They came from big cities and small towns, from across the U.S. and from other countries. They have many different ethnic backgrounds. They came from many religious backgrounds. Some have parents who are still married. Some have parents who were divorced. Some were raised by single moms. Some had parents who died. Here are a few of the people you'll meet. Michael Chasen's mom used to hear from friends that she was letting her son waste his life spending so much time playing with his computer. A few years later, he put that computer skill to use and built a company, Blackboard, that he later sold for $1.5 billion. Alexis Jones loved storytelling and acting when she was young. That could have been just a childhood diversion. Instead, she got more serious about it and eventually founded a massive online community called I Am That Girl. Today, she's an international thought leader for the women's movement and for her millennial generation. John Chu loved watching videos, then making them while still in high school. He talked his teachers into letting him submit them instead of papers. Today, he's a big-time movie director. Benny Blanco's mom got frequent complaints from his kindergarten teacher that her son wouldn't sit in the reading circle. And when he was in high school, her friends scoffed that he was wasting his time entering rap contests. Yes, he marched to a different drummer. But today, he's one of the top songwriters in the U.S., with 20 number one hits. Paige Mycoskie loved art when she was young and dreamed of one day designing clothes. When her grandparents each gave her $100 for her birthday, she bought a sewing machine, moved back home, and started sewing clothes. Today, she has 5 stores for her company, Aviator Nation. Robert Stevens loved to fix things when he was young. His parents might have bemoaned what seemed like a bent for vocational rather than professional work. Yet, this interest led him to start Geek Squad. Kevin Plank's mom used to tell him, "There are no problems. There are only solutions you haven't found yet." When he was playing college football, he was tired of sweating through his cotton t-shirts. He found a better material and started Under Armour. Are you noticing a theme? When I started interviewing entrepreneurs and their moms for this book, I thought I knew what I'd find. But what I learned was completely different. I was astonished to learn what mattered in raising an entrepreneur and what didn't. Even more than that, I was amazed by how similarly all the entrepreneurs were raised, despite the fact that their backgrounds differed wildly. These unmistakable common threads make up the 10 rules you'll learn about, and that you and your child can benefit from. This book is not about training your children to become entrepreneurs. Getting your kids to follow a path you've chosen for them is a sure way to stifle their fulfillment. And as you'll see when you read these stories, personal fulfillment is essential to an entrepreneur's life. What I hope this book will inspire you to do is to keep the road open for your child to choose, whether a broad, straight, clearly marked road or a twisty, surprising, unique one. If your kids have the entrepreneurial spirit and a taste for the road less traveled, this book will show you how to nurture it. You'll learn how to support them as they pursue their passion and their purpose, and as they make fearless and fulfilling choices. I'm so excited for your journey. Rule 1. Support a passion. Almost all the successful entrepreneurs profiled in this book have one experience in common. They had their parents, especially their mom's, support to pursue a passion, generally one that was engaged in outside of school. Whether that passion was sports, computers, music, video games, selling things to neighbors, or even protesting, it made them great future entrepreneurs. Trust your child's passion. Lots of the moms I talked to didn't get the activities their kids were into, but they also knew that their own interest or understanding was beside the point. What they went out of their way to support wasn't so much the activities themselves as the spark it brought to their children's eyes. Your own children's passions may not be the ones you would have chosen for them. Their passions may not even be something you understand. But that's actually a great thing, even if it doesn't always feel that way. It means your kids are exploring their passions in ways that are most meaningful to them, rather than following in your footsteps or trying to please you. Letting children run with their passions isn't really about helping them fulfill their childhood fantasies. It's not about helping a kid become an astronaut or a billionaire or president of the United States, though all those are possible. The true benefit is that even if a child's passion doesn't turn into a profession, they learn the joy of diving deeply into a pursuit, discovering all it has to offer, and making connections with others who are also passionate about it. Kids learn that good things happen when they do the things they love. And if they keep exploring, they find ways to improve or add to or expand or reinvent or promote the things they love. And that's how companies and organizations get started. It doesn't really matter what your child's passion is, as long as your child is passionate about something. And the most important thing you can do is nurture that passion. If you do, your child will devote lots of time to it. That's what it takes to become truly accomplished at something. Michael Chasen, Playing for Keeps. Glenda Chasen has two sons, Michael and Joel, an entrepreneur and an endodontist. Michael graduated from American University and then got an MBA from Georgetown. In 1997, he started Blackboard, an online educational technology company that he later sold for $1.5 billion. He then went on to co-found Social Radar, a tech startup that developed a location-based social app. When I talked with Glenda, she told me that growing up in the 1980s, Michael had a passion for computers, which were just becoming popular, although most people had no idea that they eventually would transform society. When Michael was in fourth grade and wanted to spend lots of time on the computer and playing video games, she nurtured those interests. Glenda told me that she had been somewhat alone in this. The other moms encouraged their children to engage in academic pursuits worthy of their intellect, as Glenda put it. Her friends told her that Michael was wasting his time. But she resisted the peer pressure and continued to encourage him as he played video games. He had a passion for gaming, she said, and he loved computers, so she not only let him spend lots of time on video games, she also told him he was wonderful for doing that. By embracing his expressed interests, she helped lead him to success. Glenda did the most important thing parents can do if they hope their children will become entrepreneurs: nurture their passion. Sports, art, chess, music, drama, fitness, computer games, volunteering, church, it doesn't really matter as long as they are passionate about something. John Chu, To Hollywood with No Connections. John Chu is a screenwriter and director best known for directing Step Up 2, The Streets, Step Up 3D, Justin Bieber, Never Say Never, G.I. Joe Retaliation with Bruce Willis and Channing Tatum, and Now You See Me 2 with Daniel Radcliffe, Jesse Eisenberg, and Mark Ruffalo. When I talked to John, he told me about his early life and how his parents supported his passion once they understood how much it meant to him. I grew up in Silicon Valley in the 80s, surrounded by people creating stuff, where engineers were the heroes. My mom came from Taiwan and my dad from China. They were both around 20 when they came to the U.S. They met when my mom was going to the College of San Mateo and a friend introduced her to my dad. They started a little restaurant in Palo Alto, Chef Chu's. It's been there over 45 years and has become a neighborhood institution. I was the youngest of five, and the oldest was only 6 years older than I was, so we were all very close. My second brother, Howard, is autistic, and so my family became okay with going with the flow. If we all went to a play and Howard didn't want to stay, we left. We learned to adapt. Today, my oldest brother, Larry, who graduated from UCLA, helps at the restaurant, which he'll take over someday. My older sister, Chrissy, is in real estate. Howard is at home with the family. And my sister, Jennifer, is married and raising two kids. My grandma helped at the restaurant with the accounting, and she used an abacus. Her feet were messed up from having been bound when she was a girl in China. My parents would tell us to look at her to realize how far our family had come in just one generation. They'd always say, "America is the greatest place on earth. If you work hard, you can achieve anything." My parents never let us work at the restaurant. They would tell us, "We didn't have many opportunities growing up, and we want you to do everything we didn't." My mom kept us super busy. I took music lessons on almost every instrument, drums, saxophone, guitar, piano, and violin. I also took tap dancing lessons and played tennis. Every weekend, we would go to San Francisco to see a show, musicals, ballet, symphony, theater. My mom thought we were royalty. My brother and sisters took etiquette classes and ballroom dancing to learn the foxtrot and waltz. She had a pretty clear idea of who she wanted us to be. The Kennedy family. My brothers and sisters and I were in all the school plays. I had the most encouraging parents. They came to everything we were in and always supported us. At the time, I thought we were really good because that's what my mom kept telling us. Looking back, we were actually really bad, but I didn't know it then. Somewhere amid all that exposure to the arts, John discovered his calling. I loved making movies for as long as I can remember. When I was in second grade, my parents gave me the video camera to shoot our family videos while we were on vacation. I had to figure out how to use it. I loved it. I was cutting stuff and editing on the VHS. I started an illustration company when I was in third grade. When I was in fourth grade, I saw an ad in a Sharper Image catalog for a $200 mixer. Suddenly, you could take music from the stereo and put music on your VHS videos. I had to have it. I called my dad at the restaurant and begged, and I talked them into buying it for me. When I got it, I cut together my vacation video and put music in it and showed my family. My parents started to cry. I knew then that I wanted to do this for my whole life. I wasn't the best musician, even though I played lots of instruments. I wasn't the best at drawing, even though I loved to illustrate. And I wasn't the best actor, even though I'd been in lots of school plays. Making movies connected all my interests, and for the very first time, I knew it's what I wanted to do forever. But even when parents are as supportive as John's, they can have a hard time seeing the value of a child's favorite activity. It's easy to worry that what a child loves has become an unhealthy obsession, one that will limit rather than expand their options. My freshman year in high school, I convinced a lot of my teachers to let me turn in videos instead of writing papers. One night, very late, when I was supposed to be asleep, my mom came into my room and saw me working on a video. Mom said it had to stop. I started crying. "This is what I love," I said. "You can't make me stop." The next day, when she came to pick me up after school, She gave me a bunch of filmmaking books and said, "If you want to do this, you have to study it and learn everything about it." From then on, my parents supported me. In fact, my whole family has supported me. For many parents, the most important part of supporting a child's passion is giving them a chance to figure out what that passion is. And often, the hardest part is accepting it, even if it isn't something you would have chosen. While he was still in high school, John started a video company, and by then, his parents were behind him. I'd shoot people's weddings and bar mitzvahs. Customers from our restaurant would find out that Chef Chu's youngest son wanted to make movies, and they would bring in beta computers to let me try. They weren't interested in keeping the computers and would give them to me because they were nice and they knew how much I wanted them. It's also an indication of how supportive my parents are that so many of our customers would give me their slightly used computers. In Outliers, Malcolm Gladwell argues that it takes 10,000 hours to become really accomplished at something. John, with all his experience making movies in high school, was a living example of the 10,000-hour rule. By the time I went to USC Film School, I was way ahead of the game. My senior year, I shot a movie. 70 people worked nonstop for 10 days. I didn't have the money to feed them, which you're supposed to do during a film shoot. So my mom, my sister, and my sister-in-law drove to LA and cooked for all of us for 10 days. It was only a short film, but it changed my life. It had its public debut at the Tribeca Film Festival, and it got me an agent and a manager. I invited my family to the premiere. My parents asked me what I'd be serving, and of course I had no idea. So my family got boxes and boxes of food and champagne, and they brought it to the theater and they served it to everyone. That's the kind of support I always have from my family. To this day, everything I tell my parents, everyone in the restaurant will know tomorrow. They put posters of all my movies on the walls. And everyone knows if you bring in a movie ticket from one of my films, you'll get a free drink at the bar. And then John told me something I heard many other entrepreneurs say about their parents in almost the same words. "I never worry about not working or make a decision based on fear because I know I have their support. Having that self-assurance means I have no fear, and so I can create what I want." My parents' whole life was to give to us, and they've had an amazing journey. They came here not speaking a word of English. They thought they could work hard and achieve the American dream, and they did. And their support and sacrifice allowed me to get into Hollywood with no connections. I also talked with John's mom, Ruth. She was one of the more involved moms I spoke with. Ruth had encouraged John's passion with everything she had, even though filmmaking wasn't necessarily what she'd had in mind for him. "I have antennae on top of my head. I always know what's going on. I always supported what John wanted to do. He was full of imagination. I have a clear picture of him at 4 years old, dreaming about something, telling fantasy stories, happy singing the songs from Aladdin and The Lion King. With school, sports, and music, he was really busy. Anything he wanted to do was okay with me, except when he played the CDs with bad words. That's where I drew the line. He never tried to do things the regular way, and I never tried to stop him. When he was 11, he wanted to be in the Palo Alto Little Theater production of Pacific Overtures. They said, 'You have to send in a resume.' He asked what that was, and I explained it was a piece of paper saying who he was. So he took a piece of paper and put his school picture on it and started drawing the Phantom of the Opera because he said that's what he wanted to be when he grew up. Everyone laughed when they saw it at the audition, but he got the part. I went to the show for 11 performances. Like most other parents, but especially because they're immigrants, John's parents wanted their son to have an even better life than theirs, but they never imagined it would be in film. Other parents might have told their son to put his camera away and focus on his schoolwork. But once John's parents realized that film was his passion, they supported him completely. Getting him equipment and later on feeding his cast and crew were a big help, But the message John took from those efforts was even more important. He always knew his parents believed in him. Jason Russell, A Balance Between Limits and Freedom. For some moms, the best way to provide support is to say, in effect, "I trust that you know what you're doing, and I believe you can succeed at whatever you put your mind to." In my interviews with entrepreneurs and their moms, I heard over and over that granting a child freedom and trust can be every bit as powerful as directly supporting a passion. That was the case with another USC-trained filmmaker, Jason Russell. Jason, the second of Paul and Cheryl Russell's four children, was born and raised in San Diego. He's the family's only entrepreneur. His brother and one of his sisters help run the Christian Youth Theater, founded by their parents, now in 40 cities. Another sister is a Hollywood hairstylist. In 2003, with Bobby Bailey and Laren Poole, Jason visited Africa and subsequently co-founded Invisible Children, a nonprofit advocacy organization created to stop Joseph Kony and his Lord's Resistance Army, LRA, in Uganda, from kidnapping children and forcing them to become soldiers. To this end, Invisible Children produced 500 videos and 12 documentaries, all directed by Jason, including Kony 2012, which was intended to pressure the U.S. government to increase its efforts to capture Kony. With 83 million online views over a period of 2 weeks, Kony 2012 became the fastest-growing viral video of all time, and Invisible Children eventually became the largest youth movement in the world, with 3.4 million likes on Facebook, second only to the Olympics. Jason told me he had always wanted to direct movies, but his earliest passion was directing plays. "I think because I was the second child, a lot of the pressure was taken off me. I grew up in a very fun atmosphere because my parents had started a children's theater, and all our friends came through the theater. Our whole life was at rehearsals. We practically lived at the theater, and to this day, most of my closest friends are people I met there. I met my wife when I was 7 and she was 6, and we were dance partners. From the time I was in 8th grade, I knew I wanted to be a movie director, and I knew I wanted to go to USC Film School. So from the time I was 15, my dad let me help direct shows to gain experience. I did go to USC and majored in filmmaking. John Chu was my freshman roommate, and we took all our film classes together. All the mothers I spoke with had in common their trust that their children would do the right thing. But there was a wide range in terms of how many rules their children were expected to follow. As Jason told me, his parents were stricter than others in some respects, yet in others, they gave him an enormous amount of freedom. "When I was growing up, my parents were very traditional, and we had no TV in our home. Later, we got one, but we could only watch on weekends. Otherwise, my parents kept it in the closet. This inspired us to make up our own games. We had to let our imaginations lead the way. I think this turned out to be important. My parents were always very trusting. Their rule was you have to be home by midnight, but if you're going to be home later, you have to call them. So that's what I did. Usually, I was home by 12 o'clock, but sometimes I'd call and say, 'I can't be home until 3 o'clock tonight,' and they'd say, 'Okay.' I made them a promise when I was 13, and I got a promise ring. I promised I wouldn't do drugs, drink, or have sex until I was 21. And because I wanted to keep the promise, I didn't do any of those. They trusted me to keep the promise. They never worried about me drinking at parties. My parents were also always very strong communicating their values. It was never about grades or how much money you should make. They always told us, 'Follow your dream. Find what you're most passionate about. We just want you to do your best and be happy in the life you choose.' I had a lot of freedom. If we wanted to go on a skateboard ramp or climb a tree, they would help. I think I had stitches at the hospital 12 different times. The day I turned 16, I got my driver's license, and 1 week later, I wanted to drive to LA, and they let me. Shortly thereafter, I wanted to drive to Mexico with friends, and they let me. And then I wanted to spend time in New York with a friend, visiting my brother, and they let me. They trusted me, and I trusted them. We would debate everything in a loving, healthy way. I felt I could tell my parents anything, and there was never any judgment. Jason told me that the freedom his parents gave him also enabled him to go to Africa, which is how he ended up starting his nonprofit. In 2000, I visited Africa with a friend and loved it. My mom was always supportive. Even when I told her I wanted to visit a war zone, she said, "You need to go. You need to fly. You need to follow your heart." After college, I bought a camera on eBay and asked a bunch of my friends to go back to Africa with me. Two said yes, Bobby Bailey and Laren Poole. While we were in Uganda, I met Jacob, one of the young boys who lived in terror that he'd be kidnapped by Joseph Kony's Lord's Resistance Army and forced to become a child soldier. I promised Jacob I'd do everything in my power to stop the war. That's what I did. Kony is on the run. We won't stop until he's been caught. I also talked to Jason's parents, Cheryl and Paul. Here's what Cheryl told me. "I have four kids, and they all have different personalities. We always told them everyone can do something to make a difference in the world in their own way." From a young age, Jason had a tender heart for people less fortunate. We'd go to Mexico, and he'd see children on the street selling chiclets, and he'd want to give them all his money. When Jason was in fourth grade, he got paid for performing in a play. He took his money and bought a camera and started filming. He's been doing it ever since. We homeschooled each of our kids for 2 years separately when they were in seventh and eighth grade. That's when their bodies and emotions changed, and we didn't want them to feel peer pressure to take unsafe risks. They all went back to public school for high school. Jason used that opportunity when he was homeschooled to spend a lot of his extra time acting. Obviously, Cheryl was willing to go to great lengths to keep her kids safe and healthy, which makes it all the more impressive that she continued to support Jason's passion even when it led him to dangerous parts of the world. When he was at USC Film School, he went with a friend on a trip to Africa, and he knew he wanted to go back. So at graduation, he said, "I want to do a documentary about the conflict in southern Sudan." Even though it was a war zone, I felt if he wanted to go, he should. But I told him that first he had to do some groundwork and meet with different people so he would have contacts there. I talked to someone who gave him the name of an African woman who worked in a school in Uganda. So he and his friends went there, and she took them to northern Uganda. And that's where he met Jacob, and Invisible Children started. In my conversations with entrepreneurs' mothers, I discovered one reason why entrepreneurs are not afraid to fail. They don't get punished for experimenting. What Cheryl told me reflected that approach. When Jason was in sixth grade, he put soap bubbles in his aunt's jacuzzi. She was hysterical. I told her, "You're going to look back on this someday and see him as a creative film director, not a hoodlum." We always say, if you get an idea, you've got to try it. We had a rule to say yes as often as possible. Whatever their dreams were, or whatever they wanted to accomplish or wanted to try, as long as they weren't putting themselves in harm's way, we would say yes. With his parents' support for his passion from the time he was in the fourth grade, Jason was able to combine filmmaking with his wish to make the world a better place. And his efforts were instrumental in getting the U.S. military involved in the hunt for Joseph Kony. Encourage exploration. Entrepreneurs tend to be ardent types, but not every future entrepreneur develops a single, all-consuming passion at an early age. Lots of future founders move from one enthusiasm to another as they grow. This kind of restless curiosity is a common trait of people who go on to create their own paths in life. That's why supporting exploration, including the possibility of false starts and detours, can be as valuable as supporting a child who's already found a true calling. Joel Holland, A Little Red Wagon Hitched to a Dream. I've known Joel since 2008, and he has a special place in my heart. Even though he's the same age as my son Elliot, Joel had started a business much earlier. When Elliot wanted to invite 18 young entrepreneurs to Utah to ski for a networking weekend, which later became Summit Series, he cold called Joel, who was the first person to sign on. Joel's also one of the nicest people I know. He sold half of his company, Video Blocks, which sells stock video clips, for $10 million in 2012. His sister, who's 2 years younger, is also an entrepreneur with her own fashion business. Joel was among a few entrepreneurs I spoke with who had a passion for selling things as opposed to the thing itself. He was running little businesses from the time he was a toddler. "I was 3 years old when I started selling gravel," Joel said. "I would walk to people's homes, take their gravel from their driveway, knock on their door, and try to sell it to them. People started calling me the Rock Man. It was crazy, but my folks were so supportive. They never said it was stupid. I loved selling things. My dad was probably standing behind me, passing my customers a dollar bill." His dad, Kent, is a lawyer, his mom, Judy, a contractor. When Joel was 5, the family moved from the DC suburbs to Southern Virginia. Every year for the next 7 years, they would build a new house, move in, sell it, and then start building a new one. Joel acquired a strong work ethic at an early age. He and his sister were given the job of sweeping. "We weren't allowed to cut corners," he said. "The floor had to be clean enough to eat off of. It taught me the value of hard work." Joel went on to tell me about the ventures that followed his stint as a door-to-door gravel vendor. "My next project was selling the little knickknacks I collected from our house. My dad went with me to the local community store and convinced them to let me sit out front and sell them. By the time I was 8, we lived near a golf course, and I knew where all the old golf balls would be at the end of the day. I would collect them, clean them up, put them in egg cartons, go to the parking lot where the golfers parked, and try to sell them. Then I decided it wasn't scalable, and I wanted to be able to sell even when I wasn't there. So I took my little red wagon and made a sign that said, 'Joel's Golf Balls.' Then I made another sign that said, 'Honor System, 3 balls for $2, and set out a Pringles can for the money. The can got stolen, so that's how I learned to protect my assets. I got a mailbox with a lock on it and put the sign on that. I left the wagon at a spot after the 9th tee. I would go every night and collect my money, usually $20 a day. It was $10 for a sleeve of 3 new balls at the pro shop, but my used ones were only $2 for a sleeve. People loved it, but the pro shop got upset and took my wagon. My dad was furious. He went over there with me and made them give me back my wagon. After that, I got a big chain and locked and tied my wagon to a tree. I clearly remember the first time I heard the word entrepreneur. I was on the 10th tee and heard some guys talking. One said, 'That kid's an entrepreneur.' I thought it was a curse word. I ran home and asked my mom, who told me what it meant. I was 11. I loved that word." Because Joel had always been encouraged to pursue his interests to the fullest, he was ready to pounce when something new came into his life, and he quickly combined a couple of his passions into a business venture. When I was 12, it was in 1997, I got my first computer. It blew my mind. Suddenly, I could sell my golf balls to the world, and nobody knew how old I was. I found eBay. I was big on Hot Wheels cars at the time. I started asking around, and I discovered there was no system to keep track of them. I found a guy who had designed software to manage inventory. I paid him $1,000 to repurpose the software so people could use it to manage hobbies and collections. Before I was 13, I was a power seller on eBay, selling thousands of dollars a month of the software. Nobody knew my age. I realized how powerful it was to be anonymous on the internet. I had over 2,000 transactions with positive ratings. My parents were very supportive. They would drive me to the post office to pick up checks and then drive me to the bank. They never questioned how I was spending my time. Although Joel stumbled into his next venture.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.